This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your monthly guest host, Kelly Chase. Whitley will be back in the captain's chair next week. Today, I'm bringing you a conversation with an exciting new voice in the UFO UAP world, Lester Nare. Lester is the founder of the UAP Caucus, which is an independent, community-driven platform for elevating the UAP conversation. Lester is one of a loose cohort, of which I consider myself to be a part, of youngish private sector professionals who have come to the space in the past few years with the intention of using our existing skill sets to support increased transparency around the UAP issue. Some of my favorite conversations and connections from the last year have been with people who are building new organizations and initiatives to do exactly this kind of work. And I'm excited to share one such conversation with you here today. The work that the UAP Caucus is doing is complex and ambitious, so let's dive into it. Here's my conversation with Lester Nare. Well, hi, Lester. Welcome to Dreamland. How are you?
I'm doing well, Kelly. Really a pleasure to be here.
Oh, well, it's so great to have you. I've been really looking forward to having this conversation and to, you know, you and I've gotten to catch up a little bit lately, and I'm so interested in what you've been doing and I'm really excited to introduce you to the Dreamland audience. So, you know, let's start with my favorite place to start. One of my favorite questions, which is just, how did you get into this whole UFO world? What are you doing here?
I get this question a lot lately as more and more people in my own network have started to see some of the stuff that I've been working on. And, you know, I think like a lot of folks, it happened really organically. There were probably a couple of elements that led me to this place. When I was growing up, I was a big soccer player. I was a big soccer family. That was really what our entire lives revolved around. One of the few childhood memories that I do have that was not soccer related that is interesting is my dad and I used to fly these model rockets and model planes. Very amateur, but it was one of the first things that really got me introduced to the concept of aerospace in general. And then from there, probably the first inciting incident, I had a very mundane sighting in 2011, 2012. The weird thing about it was it happened twice. It was, you know, classic spherical orb-shaped object, extreme maneuverability, amber in color. At the time, I didn't really know what box to put it in. So it kind of was just the, oh, that was weird. But, you know, for any number of reasons, I just didn't really grab hold onto it as something more than, you know, maybe something that was the classic advanced military craft, what have you. I think the turning point for me that really allowed me to dive in was after the WikiLeaks dumps came out in 2015, 2016, and in those emails included some conversations between government officials, people outside the government related to this concept of, you know, capital D disclosure. And by this time, I had done a lot of digging. I'd been all through all the internet forums, read some books. So I had an understanding of the long history of the subject. But for whatever reason, I think as a politico and a policy wonk at the time, it made it really concrete for me because I was seeing it sort of manifest in an environment that I felt had sort of a chain of custody type of context. And at that point, I became sort of much more active in the conversation, but I wasn't a public figure. Post 2017, like many folks, was really the sort of it's go time moment where, okay, this is, you know, a serious issue. And what I felt was at the time that most of the media coverage, both in the mainstream and independent media, I think were not really capturing the magnitude of the legislative process that was happening around the what was now the UAP topic. And so I really just started out with a TikTok and would just do these summary videos, assuming the audience knew nothing. And that kind of took off quite a bit. And I think that's led to the launch of our organization, UAP Caucus, and I think really becoming much more politically involved in the disclosure lane or the public advocacy and transparency lane of the subject.
Oh, that's awesome. It's always so interesting to hear what gets people in the door, you know, and often it's exciting and yeah, cool. So with the UAP Caucus, can you talk a little bit about what that is exactly and like what your goals are?
Yeah, definitely. So I'm sure many listeners, you know, last year post David Grush coming forward in his testimony in front of the House Oversight Committee and then the release of the Schumer Amendment or the UAP Disclosure Act, you know, there was a moment where, you know, there were a few different entities that recognized the need for an actual political action type groups or network. We really haven't been, as a community, involved in the political space from an advocacy perspective. We have been involved with government in terms of the decades of history of researchers connecting and aggregating the experiences of those who are former government officials or contractors. But in terms of advocating as a political movement for legislation to be passed to address the issue, we hadn't really seen that infrastructure. So UAP Caucus was ultimately created as a volunteer organization focused on sort of both education and advocacy around this subject. So a lot of what we do are white papers. We have a really fantastic interactive web portal that we sort of call as an on-ramp for folks who, you know, might have seen something in the news, maybe they saw something in a book or an article, but they don't know where to start in terms of trying to understand what's actually happening, and specifically as it relates to the U.S. government's involvement in the subject from a contemporary legislative perspective. And as we've seen over the past 4 to 5 years, there has been a significant amount of not only a sort of call it palace intrigue, as we've seen more members in Congress, you know, step out in front of the cameras and really sort of take this issue seriously, as well as the ongoing pieces of legislation coming out of both the House and the Senate, the creation of these government programs, the NASA study. There's just a lot going on. And you usually see a lot of the coverage be very topical and not provide follow-on material or ways to, for people who want to dive into the details to understand what is the implication of X, Y, or Z. So we sort of operate like a skunk's work project to try to really have a rapid response to the ever-changing and quickly changing environment that is the UAP subject, particularly in DC.
Very cool. Something you hinted at a little bit earlier was kind of the enormity of the challenge that we're facing. Can you talk a little bit about how you see that landscape of, like, what does that challenge look like and kind of what are the gaps that need to be filled?
Easy question. I was going to say, I'm taught like a whole week to be able to break down. I mean, it's extremely complex, right? So the framework that I try to use as a starting point, and again, this topic is very robust. So I know there are some people who are going to say, oh, you missed this or you missed that. But at least as a starting point, I sort of think about it in three lanes where you have obviously the capital D disclosure lane, which is kind of the work we just talked about. And there are a lot of folks who obviously have this perception that the government is never going to voluntarily do so, which I think is a very fair assessment of the reality of the situation. You then have a middle lane, which is sort of this discovery process. So you have the actual scientific and academic study, first principle study and research in order to acquire a larger data set to try to go through the process of detection, characterization, and evaluation of the phenomenon itself. And then the third lane I sort of categorize as understanding. And this is more so a lane where if you talk about folks who are experiencers, folks who've been in and around the subject for a long period of time, who are not necessarily having the conversation of, are they real? And, you know, how long has it been happening? But have either a very personal and visceral experience that is undeniable, or have a connection, whether through acquiring information or someone they know, that they feel that way. That conversation now is more about getting into the deeper second and third order questions that are beyond the, is it real? It's like, what is it? What are the mechanics under which it operates? How does it engage with me? Like communication, CE5, there's like a whole spectrum there. So at a high level, those are the buckets I try to sort of start from. And then within each of those, you have several ongoing initiatives, projects, news updates, things that are going on. And I think the interesting gaps in, if you assume that landscape as a baseline, right? So in my view, they are all reinforcing cycles of each other. So as a practical example, if you look at the current ecosystem in the discovery space, you have organizations like Galileo Project run out of Harvard or the Seoul Foundation run out of Stanford that are trying to increase the academic rigor and starting from a first principles perspective to study the issue. And as there is progress made in the scientific discovery lane, right? For example, we noticed that when you have a certain level of depth of clarity in your sensing systems, you are able to actually X, Y, and Z. Well, now when the reality becomes tangible in a peer review kind of scientific context, the pressure now increases in the capital D disclosure lane that we talked about earlier, where the political capital necessary to advocate for UAP legislation is less and the risk is less. And so that can be a reinforcing cycle in that context. The same thing goes for the understanding, right? One of the things I've talked about with what we've seen recently in Congress is the challenge with this issue for many people who are not personally experiencers is that it is so abstract. There's no foundational grounding for them to really latch onto it. And I noticed this in watching the Havana Syndrome hearings in the Senate, where they focused on the veterans, the men and women who've served this country valiantly, who have suffered the effects of anomalous health incidents or Havana Syndrome. And what you noticed was that the members in Congress were able to attach emotionally to the subject in a way that wasn't abstract but concrete. And so I bring all that context up to say, I don't believe there is really good cohesion between leading efforts across the disclosure, discovery, and understanding lanes, where we are able to self-reinforce each other, right? In ways where, you know, again, we all have our own on-ramps for people who might be new and coming from those different angles, but they all kind of interrelate. So I think a big challenge we have right now is how do we integrate? We basically are, it's almost like this internecine warfare where everyone has their little sort of area of land and they are defending it as the most important part of the subject. And this is what we need to lead with in public discourse. And this is how we get to a better understanding. And I think it's going to ultimately be some combination of those three, among other things, that is ultimately going to allow us to drive more people to have a contemporary understanding of what the latest information is. Again, one of the big things is most people have a preconceived notion because of decades of the way this has been framed in media and news before, and breaking down those barriers is extremely difficult. And as such, we need to, I think, really find ways to integrate these different aspects. I think Seoul tries to do it in the academic sense, where they look at sort of cross-functional or cross-discipline integration as a key thing they focus on. I think we can do that almost one level up across the entire kind of topic as well. Long-winded answer, but it's a complex question.
No, it's a great answer. It's a great answer. And it's part of the reason I was excited to have you on the show and to have this conversation, because, you know, I think that, as you and I have discussed, I have On Top Loops Productions, which is, a media company that's really more focused on kind of the integration side of things for people who don't necessarily really need to be convinced, but who want to understand, who want to understand more about it, figure out how they, integrate this into their lives. And then, the work that you're doing is more kind of on that kind of leading edge of the conversation with the public, with people who aren't as familiar with this. And I think that there's so much strife and infighting sometimes in the community, or at least that's the perception, I think.
Fair. No, that's fair.
Right. But I think that at its core, there is a new kind of wave of us young, I'll put it in quotes, people who are coming into the space who understand the complexity of the problem. And we know that we can each only work on our part of it, but that the opportunity for us to come together is huge. And, we've had, our teams have had conversations. We were just at Contact in the Desert and had some great conversations, Matt Ford over the Trouble Show. And all of those conversations have been very collaborative about how we need kind of all of these things. It's a multi-front problem and we need people fighting on all of those fronts. So I think, you made some really fantastic points in there. And the other thing I think is really cool about what you're doing is that you're bringing some real kind of business and organizational acumen to the work that you're doing. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that, because I think that there's been a real push, especially among younger folks, where like we're having these conversations about like how do we professionalize the field, and that in some ways that's seen as being a like a bad thing, or that like people are grifting, or that it's just about money. It's like, no, like if we're going to get things done, we need to take lessons from well-run organizations and well-run initiatives to try to figure out. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about like how you see that and how your other kind of professional experience has informed the work that you're doing now.
So I great question. I am continuing the strong legacy of real estate based entrepreneurs that are trying to make, you know, real impact in this space. Obviously referring to both the combination of Bob Bigelow at Bigelow Aerospace, who's sort of the OG of the real estate entrepreneur turned, you know, advocate for the subject, and then followed by Brandon Fugel, who's the owner at Skinwalker Ranch. So similar to them, I am a sort of founder for a real estate based technology company currently, and have been in the early stage tech space for the greater part of the last decade. I'm based here in Los Angeles. And so my entire life, you know, has really revolved around this concept of how do you go from zero to one, which is one of Peter Thiel's famous concepts, right? When you are building a new company, in our case, we're doing a down payment assistance product for consumers, there you have nothing. You're starting from zero context, zero understanding, zero reference point. And then you then have to be able to convert that first person and then scale up to millions. And what you kind of learn in the process, and I think this is kind of why you see the folks of myself, Fugel and Bigelow, all kind of stepping into a space like this, is we have the tools and understanding of the integration of new ideas and operational execution and capital. At the end of the day, if you want there to be more scientific engagement and investigation into the subject, if you want there to be, you know, hearings and things happening in Congress, if you want private citizens to start their own crash retrieval program or create their own projects where we're creating our own sensor platforms, every single one of those things costs money. There is no pathway to this idea of consensus as opposed to capital D disclosure, because I think the more important factor is that there's some sort of critical mass of people that understand. But if that is the end goal you're going for, it's not going to come for free. The only universe, in my view, that it comes for free is like some sort of mass sighting situation, right? So let's kind of put that to the side. What can we do to impart change? Even things like bring bigger awareness, advertising. Advertising costs money, right? So it's the practical reality of the society, the capitalistic society we live in today. So if you want to have that conversation, that's, I think, a different podcast. But given that context, I think part of the reason I come with an operator's mindset is the work that I do. And I do think that there is an understandable hesitation to the introduction of the professionalization of the industry. And I think a part of that comes from the analogy I sort of sometimes bring up is, it's like in music, when people find an artist when they're really early in their cycle, no one really knows them about it yet, and they can be one of their first followers, and they go to their first concert, they're one of the first 100 people. Then when they're all of a sudden have a number one hit, it's like, oh, I was there first. All you new people don't get it. You're ruining it. This is no longer good music. So it's. I think there's a little bit of that tension where necessarily as more people, if we want this to happen, more people are going to be involved in the topic. As you get more people involved in the topic, how do we aggregate the energy most effectively? So I think in my view, one of the things as a millennial that I think was missing, and I think with UAP Caucus, we've really been a leader in defining what does user experience in the context of like software look like in the modern era for this subject. And there really hasn't been a modern app style, you know, platform that is educational around the subject matter that is in the way that people are used to seeing on DoorDash and Uber and, you know, the way that apps work today. And the reason some of that stuff matters is the internet gives us scale. I wrote this blog post last year about this concept that historically you've had these power centers, you know, in antiquity, it's like religion. And then you have the state, as sort of in our most recent modern era are these entities that are the dominant power structure that creates control of how we move forward as a species. And the interesting thing about the rise of the internet is it is now becoming the title of the post was the three Leviathans, religion, the state, and the internet. And the reason this is important is when you talk about the concept of the truth embargo or all this stuff, that's been able to exist because the state has been able to exert power over the control of information. When you now have decentralized communication networks that allow you to disseminate information outside of the control of those central actors, I think this is why you're starting to see this begin to spill out more, because we're able to get like-minded communities together and amplify that message. And one of the best ways to show to people who already have a preconceived notion about the subject that this is not your grandfather's UFO topic anymore, it's elevating how we present information, how we communicate about it, introducing more nuance. And again, that necessarily has costs associated with it. At the same time, we have people who've done decades of incredible work that allow us to stand on the shoulders of those giants, and they deserve to have been compensated for that work. At the end of the day, and I know you as a creative, you get this, this stuff takes time and energy, and there should be justifiable compensation for it. There are ways in which people are manipulating the subject in order to monetize it in a disingenuous way. But there is clearly a large now group of folks who are trying to do it the right way, who are creating the right operational and execution structures that will actually enable the success we're all looking to get to, right? This is a goal-oriented concept to some degree, whether you want to say it's to understand more about what it is or for there to be capital D disclosure. That's a goal-oriented direction, and the best entities we've created as a species to get there are these ideas of these businesses, this capitalistic driver, where there's an incentive to get to the destination. This is going to happen whether we like it or not. And I'll just end it with this. One interesting thing coming from the tech space, especially recently, is the amount of high net worth individuals that are very interested in this subject and are not sitting on the sidelines anymore. So whether we like it or not, it's happening. And I think for a lot of folks, there would be a preference that grassroots movements are able to establish some kind of foothold in the future of this conversation and it not be held up solely by these private corporate mass entities outside of the alleged old school legacy program contractors.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. And on that note, we're going to take a quick break. So I resonated with so much of what you said. I also come from a kind of tech startup background and early stage tech startups. And I find that there's actually a lot of us in the community who are thinking this way, who are working in this direction. And it is about, you know, kind of understanding the problem, breaking down the problem and moving towards a goal in an orderly fashion and in a realistic fashion, right? And so I think that's something that's really exciting to me that's kind of going on in the community right now. Going back to your idea about kind of the different lanes around this topic, let's start with kind of the discovery lane, because I think that one is one that kind of everybody can get excited about, right? Because I think that ultimately, if you're in this, if you get into this crazy field, if you have an interest in this topic, it's because you want to know, right? Like you want to know what this thing is and what's going on. But it's so complicated. You know, they say like, just do the science, just where's the evidence, you know, the people pounding their fists on Twitter and all of that. But it's far more complicated than that. Can you talk a little bit about what we're up against in terms of the discovery aspect of this? Considering that so much of the information and knowledge about this phenomenon presumably is like highly classified and has been kind of stovepiped and in many ways kept away from the public.
I mean, this is a real challenge, right? Because you have this born secret issue around the UFO subject, it then cascades into the stigma that's been instilled over this long period of time. And what you end up getting is there's a couple things. One, particularly in academia and these scientific study programs, again, you need funding. Who's one of the biggest funders for these subjects? The government, right? So when you talk about, you know, foundational scientific research, you do have private sources of capital that, you know, such as in the context of Dr. Avi Loeb, he got a private funder to do his exhibition down to Papua New Guinea for the IM-1 retrieval project. So you do have that in some cases, but a large amount of the real capital for this comes from places like the National Science Foundation, NIH, et cetera. And the thing with that is when you have that stigma that is instilled from the Born Secret issue, it permeates into the capital allocators around what topics are deemed, you know, legitimate and worth study. So you have the stigma issue at the funding level as one problem. So this is, again, part of the reason why we believe that the disclosure lane is important to discovery, because as it gets more relevant in Congress, the ability for it to be destigmatized and then more money to be allocated can happen. A perfect example of this is last year, there was a National Science Foundation, UAP, conference meeting that was held where they're now allocating a very small dollar amount to the continued figuring out how NSF can engage in the subject. That hasn't happened before. So that's kind of what happens when you get the destigmatization. So funding and stigma and funding. You then also have stigma in peer review. So peer review is the end all be all in sort of capital S science, right? That's really, and you want to not only have peer review, you want to have it in a prestigious, you know, journal that has a long history of highly credible work. And in that context, you have a cadre of folks who have been there, who are the controllers of what is deemed legitimate science and not legitimate science. And so within that aspect, even though there's scientific work being done on UAP at a high volume right now with high levels of scientific rigor, the ability for that to get visibility by being published in a highly lauded journal is still a roadblock, not because the work isn't being done, but because they're not letting it through that process to begin with. So funding and peer review, I think, are two major challenges in the discovery lane currently. I think that's changing quite a bit. So that's not going to be a permanent state. I mean, it's changing real time as we speak. I think the other challenge, which is maybe a little bit more abstract, is the defining the problem. Because it's sort of like you're searching for something that you don't yet understand. Where do you start? The cold start problem. And I think there's been a lot of great papers in the last years, especially trying to like outline what does scientific research for UAP look like? What are the standards of evidence? What, you know, are the detection platforms that we can utilize, you know, whether it's any variety of mediums. So for all these reasons in combined, right? And you could argue which is first order to sort of deal with, it has made the adoption of the subject as a legitimate line of inquiry historically challenging. But to that end, I mean, just from the network that the small limited network and anecdotal conversations that I'm able to have, that's definitely changing. Both because private capital allocators are stepping into the space and in much higher volume, and the quality of the recent work on UAP research that's now being published by the likes of the AIAA UAP Integration and Outreach Committee, or SOL, is bringing in more academics and legitimizing the conversations within their own ivory towers.
Absolutely. And something I find so interesting about where things have been heading over the last few years, and things that, you know, I think that this is something that SOL is definitely working to champion, is the inclusion of more of the humanities in this conversation. Like, the sciences can be really tough and they tend to be more expensive, right, to actually get work done. And so not only I think, you know, the humanities are important for a lot of reasons in helping us understand this, but it seems like we're getting, like, the humanities are a good way to get our foot in the door in terms of legitimizing the conversation within, like, the academy. Is that something that you're kind of seeing on your end as well?
So this is a great note, Kelly, because I think you're absolutely right. I mean, there's a couple of ways to think about this. One is the default mindset we have from the hard sciences might actually create a limiting viewpoint that then is actually going to miss where to actually start and get the sort of the discovery process really humming, because again, they have this sort of very empirical lens that might lend them to not be able to think in the way that someone who's coming from a humanities background would approach the problem with a different kind of entry point potentially. So I think that's one piece. But also to your point that the humanities is a great way to as a great starting point. There's especially because there's such a long existing record by which you could have a discussion from that humanities context to really sort of, I think, and this is something that Peter Scafish at Seoul, I think, is incredible at. Same with the likes of like Dr. Jeffrey Kripal, but I think he's coming more from the religious studies angle, Diana Pasolka. I mean, what you've seen is if you look at podcasts that are not specific to this subject and who gets brought on, especially lately, it's a lot of the academics coming at the subject from the humanities angle. And it's actually become a huge on-ramp to expanding, again, because they're coming at it with a high level of intellect and I think having interesting conversations that you don't hear in the 5-minute news block on News Nation or, you know, get in the dense text of a 68-page paper. I do find that that's been one of the biggest drivers to at least an independent media, an increase in the amount, in the exposure that people are getting to the subject. And this is probably an area I'm less qualified to kind of speak to, but I we're going to need to have the humanities and sort of the classic or hard sciences really integrate and work in lockstep, because the implications at the individual psychological level, at the sociological level, the philosophical level, you know, when we talk about then what is the meaning of things like sovereignty, right? What does it mean to be human? What is the implication for religion? You know, how are different religions going to respond? Are they going to latch on to existing archetypes and point to this as evidence of those existing archetypes? Will they be able to bucket it as something fundamentally new and different? As a funny side note, the Vatican recently put out their updated sort of standards for how they deal with and process supernatural occurrences. And they did make the distinction that there's those supernatural occurrences that fall within the realm of their sort of religious domain. And then there's UFO stuff, which is, they're like, that's kind of a different thing. So there's so many things to unravel that are not going to be anything about the nuts and bolts or whether it gives us infinite energy. I mean, if you talk about it has a power source that provides energy, then you have to think about economics and geopolitics. And so it's in my view, there's almost more to deal with on that side of the train tracks than the analysis. And we can be having those conversations and beginning to build out these frameworks, which I think is so important, a way for people to be able to put it in some kind of context. So I think that side of the conversation is so fascinating.
I completely agree. And I love what you were kind of saying about, you know, about how the way that we approach things, whether it be through a scientific lens or, you know, a humanities lens, can sometimes like put blinders on us and have us only see the problem from a certain perspective. Something that I really love on the UAP Caucus website is you guys have kind of a giant list of all the different, and it's interactive, of all the different theories for what this phenomenon could be. And it's really comprehensive. In fact, I don't know that I've seen a list that's quite as comprehensive. So really, you know, kudos to you for that. Can you talk a little bit about the challenge of that, of trying to get people, first of all, like, how did you even go about putting that whole list together? And then, like, the challenge of trying to explain this to people who are coming into it with this sort of, it's aliens in a flying saucer from, you know, Zeta Reticuli or wherever, you know, that we kind of see in the media as being the only way that's represented.
I love this part of the conversation, because I find it so fascinating that people distill down the possibilities to it's aliens or it's the government. And that's like the only two options as a binary choice, which leaves out so many things. So originally we have these like study guides that are just like sort of explainer pages with a variety of different topic matters. We had originally done a theories version there that was very small scale, but was the starting point to what we now are sort of have labeled the origin classification system, or OCS. And frankly, the labeling was an expansion on the presentation by Colonel Carl Nell at the Seoul Foundation, November of 2023 at Stanford, where he was having a discussion about, at that time, the UAP Disclosure Act and what that sort of timeline looked like. The slide actually was presented live, but was not presented in the online portion that was released to the public. But ultimately, the full deck had been released via some folks. Anyway, and one of those was this, they called it like a, they had a different title for it. What we sort of did was we took it, it had no definitions. It just had labels. And some of the stuff on there was super fascinating. I think one of the things that was really great about it was it included not only sort of the physical direction, as well as the sort of esoteric, interdimensional, kind of like highly advanced physics concepts stuff, and then also metaphysical. So a lot of times people either come at it from the purely metaphysical, the purely physical, or the purely other stuff bucket. And having an interactive tool that allows you to see the relationship between these, how they're sort of categorized, especially because when you look at the way that it's set up, when you look at prosaic, and then there's like sources government, and then you look at extraterrestrial, there's 96 total like options for, we sort of break down to theory, sub-theory, micro theory. So there's kind of like levels. So for example, within prosaic, you can have like weather, or you could have government, or you can have extra government, or you can have private aerospace, all under a prosaic bucket. What's so fascinating about every time I pull that up and show it to somebody, right? And I always talk about it all the time. Anytime I see, for example, Dr. Sean Kirkpatrick making the statement, the Arrow has not been able to find any evidence of technology of extraterrestrial origin. Why is that the framing? What is your definition of extraterrestrial, and why have you decided that that is the sole, like, you know? And again, people will obviously claim they're doing semantic dancing there. And I do think that that's a reasonable thing to push back on, because it can be anomalous and also not extraterrestrial and also not human, right? So there's this unnecessary narrowing of what are the potential hypotheses for origin that I think is doing a disservice to the breadth of experiences that people are legitimately having, right? That have a whole spectrum that don't just all necessarily fall into it's my labs or it's, you know, ET, right? I'm particularly fascinated by some of the metaphysical stuff. I don't really come with a huge, whether you want to call it religious or spiritual, historical understanding. So that's an area I'm really trying to grow in. But, you know, concepts like the jinn, right? Which is, you know, or any of these spirits, my family's from Zimbabwe. We have historically, the elders have a very superstitious thought process about a variety of things that would be viewed as being classified as paranormal or any of the stuff that we're talking about, but it's very much ingrained and a part of their everyday. So one of the things I think in the West we struggle with is not integrating, I think, some of the less materialistic ways of viewing the world into how we think about the conversation about the origins of the UFO phenomenon, which again, also cascades into hitchhiker effect and all of these other manifestations that don't necessarily have to do anything with craft and bodies.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back. I think that you're so right about this kind of weird dichotomy that exists in our, it's really kind of a cultural thing where we kind of put science over here and metaphysics over here and never the two shall meet. And yet there's so much about the UFO phenomenon and just about kind of the more anomalous parts of human experience in general that seem to suggest that that division is really kind of an artificial one and one that doesn't really necessarily work anymore. But it does kind of create problems for people who are trying to do science, right? Because I think it's hard to get these ideas off the ground, really.
100%. No, 100%. And that's why I think, again, it's a yes and. We need a yes and approach, not an either or. And I think we have the same mindset about this, which is there's nowhere near enough groups or organizations or things happening. And I know people are like, oh, it's too many people. We're not even close. And to that end, you know, I think we can be having folks focusing on the hard sciences, the rigorous, you know, scientific inquiry, data sets, you know, reproducibility, all of that. That's going to have to be a part of this process. But I do think there is a space in which, you know, we also need to engage with, again, the other side of this equation that's not as easy to put into the reproducibility bucket, because, you know, if something is not reproducible, that doesn't mean, you know, it's not happening. But I understand in the context of science and then, you know, creating sort of this fact-based record, you're going to need to see that. I think we'll see, especially over the next probably 12 to 24 months, that just given what we sort of are hearing is in the things that people are working on, I think you're going to see an acceleration in both lanes, both in terms of the number of different people that are doing work and research and talking publicly about it, and also the results of those things. I mean, a perfect example is the Limina Journal for UAP Studies, which was a new scientific journal, peer-reviewed journal that launched sometime last year. They have a request for papers out. The lead is a professor from, I want to say, it's a UK based university. Excuse me for missing that in this moment. But he put out a request for papers. He comes from he's a law professor, and so his angle is, look, a lot of testimony, witness testimony, is written off in scientific inquiry because of the reproducibility problem, all this other stuff. And he's like, okay, great. But what if we look at the historical record of, you know, alien abduction based witness testimony that's in criminal, like in law, like in the record of past court cases, and use that as a way to create a framework of what should be the legal implications in these situations, which we already have on record, and trying to sort of make the legal arguments around how should those testimonies be categorized and qualified in the context of sort of civil and criminal law. And they are going to do these mock case studies and like walk through like how they would do it based on that new framework. That's the kind of stuff that people are doing, again, because there is data. Some of it is not censored data, which is a lot of the hard science wants to look for. But these are the nuanced and creative angles I think we're starting to see about how can we take this long history and start to put some of this framing around it that is practical to us operating today, right? Because the implication of that is it's then going to set a potential, you know, standard for how the legal system should address the sort of alien abduction testimony problem. So I think there's going to be a lot of fascinating work here. And this is again going from zero to one. So we're sort of in the cave in the dark, pointing flashlights in every direction, trying to find where the arrows are pointing. But I think there's a lot more people with a lot more flashlights now.
Absolutely. I loved so much too that you brought up Carl Nell's talk at Seoul. I was lucky enough to be there, and I don't know that any single talk that I've seen has ever had such an impact on me in terms of how much it changed the way that I see what's happening. And I think that, like, afterwards I felt like grateful and almost like a little that I'd like been naive before about like exactly how big of a problem we're facing. Because what was so clear to me in Carl Nell's talk was that, number one, the government absolutely is taking this extremely seriously, that this has been talked about and for a long time on a very high level, and that they also understand the enormity of the problem that they're facing. But hearing from someone like him with this like military intelligence background, and to really understand that, like, that they're not going to just decide to, like, capital D, disclose all of this one day, because there's a million reasons why that's actually a bad idea. Not necessarily, I mean, I, as a private citizen, don't necessarily have to agree with that. But in terms of the way that our military intelligence apparatus makes decisions and mitigates risk and tries to just, like, keep the country together, like the math doesn't math, as the kids say. Like, there's not, it's never going to, it just doesn't add up, even for people who really do want there to be greater transparency, because there's just too much risk in terms of what it'll do to us culturally and to the stability of the country and all of these other things. But I think that only put it more into focus for me that these sort of grassroots initiatives and speaking to the public directly, and I think this ties into the congressional side, you know, the legislative side of things also, because without the kind of push and the mandate of the greater public saying, we want this, like, that's the only way to ever change that math for them. And so I'd love to talk a little bit about that, about like what does it look like, you know, the challenge of trying to talk to the public about what's going on here and to get people to sort of take this seriously.
I think you're 100% right in that. And this is very unpopular amongst folks who are members of the UFO and UAP community, which apparently are two separate communities, but we'll have that discussion.
Right.
But it's very controversial because, you know, understandably, and I think a lot of people, their entry point to this is, I want to know, right? That's, I want to know the truth. I deserve to know the truth, which is something that is totally valid to be in a position to feel. I also would like to know. But I think the difference is then you take the next step up to say, okay, when you have this, these systems, these institutions have inertia, right? That moves them in certain directions because of 200, 300 years of how we've sort of operated here in the States. They're not going to about face on something overnight. That, again, think about all of the potential exposure and implications. And again, not just for the government, but generally, you have the amount of lawsuits that are going to happen as a result of this, the immediate legal exposure for a number of possible entities within and around the government is going to be massive. And again, justifiable, but we don't even have then the legal sort of precedent for how to even address any of that, because we're not having the conversations in law schools and rooms where that could sort of happen. So there's all of that stuff. What happens to ownership rights? What are ownership rights for non-terrestrial or non-human objects of technological origin? That's going to be a whole argument and fight. When money is made from this stuff, does it get taxed? How does it get taxed? Who does it get taxed? What about airlines? Okay, what happens if there's a midair collision? What happens if people start getting the ability to start flying? So there's also now the prevention of, from an air safety perspective, first responders. What happens when you're now understand that this is a real thing and people are having contact experiences and they're having medical things happening as a result of that. There's all of that stuff. I mean, I'm not even scratching the surface here. Like, this is like shorter than a short list. There are 1,001 things that, again, we deserve as the public to have a right to know if we're alone in the universe. At the same time, we don't want civilization to be in an untenable position as a result of learning that information, because we might be prepared for that information. A lot of people are not prepared for that information. Now, I do believe the idea that there's going to be like this, like a purge reaction when it comes. I think it is a little bit overblown from the way it's been framed by some of the former government officials, but it's a non-trivial issue. It's not like everyone's just going to continue doing whatever. Yeah, maybe you and your friends group and your limited social circle of what you view as a worldview, but there's 8 billion people on this planet. You know what I'm saying? And culturally speaking, some cultures are not going to respond in the open-minded way I have other things to worry about that we might here in the U.S. And again, we're in a global economy. So if you now have a negative reaction in a region where we have manufacturing capacity, now that's going to have an economic impact on us directly, even if every person in the U.S. goes to work like nothing's changed. So I think it's easy to dismiss the like, oh, it's not going to change anything. It obviously changes everything. If it's the biggest story in the history of mankind, which everyone always frames it as, it necessarily is going to have the biggest impact on mankind over anything ever. You can't have your, both things have to be true, right? So with that being said, the challenge, and this is why the government doesn't want to touch it, this is why it's been a difficult process for a long period of time, is how do you even start the conversation? Like, how do you begin to have these on-ramps in order to enable the rolling out of the information to have a less sort of stark or drastic impact? And obviously, I think, you know, nowadays, especially within the West, we have a lot of context and reference points that, you know, it's not going to be, I think, super surprising for a lot of people. But a perfect example, I literally saw this 2 days ago. It's a video of, there's this prank. Someone created a video clip of the emergency broadcast system, right? That then tunes into a message from the president about unknown objects flying over certain US cities and da da da. Basically the fake alien invasion prank. And there was one, someone did it to their mom from Boston who had—
I just watched that this morning.
You know what I'm talking about. And like, it's funny, but the reaction of the mom was an authentic, organic reaction to receiving that information without context in real time. And I think people underestimate how many people would have that exact same reaction all at the same time. So I do think, and it's like we've been talking about already earlier in this call, I think Carl Nell mapped it out really well. You have different industries or different verticals that are going to have to engage in this topic in different ways. So I think he broke it down as like government, academia, private industry, and there was one more that that's escaping me right now. But the point is, in each of those lanes, you need to have the conversation happening that's specific to how does the government engage in the issue? How does the private sector need to engage in the issue? How does academia engage in the issue? And then maybe the last one was like the philosophy, humanities, sociology, like the cultural impact. How do we have discussions in our mainstream media environment right now where we have a super divided walled gardens of information that is only being fed to us to either rage bait us or reinforce the beliefs that we already have? I mean, there are real structural challenges to getting the information in front of the people that don't already have the information. Part of that's algorithmic, part of that's stigma. So I think, you know, we've decided to choose, I think the best thing to do is choose a very narrow lane, get as narrow as possible, because you're going to be able to connect more with a smaller but more engaged audience by being able to speak in a way that connects with them. So for me, I'm a policy wonk and I'm a technologist. So I talk about it from a policy perspective and from a technology perspective. That allows me to exist in both the disclosure and discovery lane, because the policy is the disclosure side, the technologist is on the discovery side. And just sticking there has already been overwhelming enough, but it's been incredible to see just by me publicly being a reasonable, rational person. I don't know what the origin of UFOs or UAP are. I do believe that this is a real phenomenon that's engaging on a consistent basis in a variety of theaters. I'm not saying that. The US government's saying that. The Canadian government's saying that. The Japanese government's saying that. The UK, the EU, you know, is saying. So this is not a matter of decades of testimony from credible people all over the place. But I don't know what it is. And that's okay. But I think we still need to make people feel comfortable having a conversation, albeit that might be slightly speculative, but at least trying to ground it in anchors that allow us to not get dragged into the rabbit hole, right? That is the subject. So it's complicated. I think staying narrow is of utmost importance. It allows you to get deeper. It allows you to touch point people, I think, more closely. And on-ramps are the number one thing that we can be doing right now, regardless of what angle you're coming in from or what you believe is the best way to go about this process. The answer is going to involve more on-ramps. And when I say on-ramps, I mean doors for people to walk into to begin to learn about and engage in the subject. The biggest issue we've had as a community historically, I know I say this and beat this drum to death, but we need to stop having insular conversations and trying to have a battle over a limited amount of territory, right? And sort of claim ownership on this thing because we were there first. We need to have outward-facing conversations that assume that the audience does not have the same lexicon and understanding of the nuances of dropping, oh yeah, and Dolan and da-da-da, and we were talking with the Wilson Davis notes, and there's just so much of that is really a turnoff for most people who are just getting started. So I think we need to reframe how we think about who our audience is, and it's not each other. We're already there, right? Obviously, in this context, it's different, but if we're thinking about how do we grow the pool, how do we grow the pie, it necessarily has to mean stop thinking about how other people are going to respond. They're going to have their opinion and they're going to have their lane, especially the grifter debunker crew. Like, that's fine. We need to go where the grass is green, and we have beaten it to death within our own circles. So in any event, I think there's a lot of work to be done in this arena. A lot. We need more. We need it higher quality. We need it in different kind of flavors. But ultimately, that's going to spur bringing in more really incredibly passionate, willing to do the work, smart people that is going to drive that public outcry that will subsequently force the hand in either the disclosure, the discovery, or understanding lanes.
I couldn't agree more. Well, this is a great place for us to leave off with the public version of the show. Lester and I are going to continue for about another half hour or so talking about what he sees coming up this year in kind of the disclosure lane. And so for those of you who are paid members, we'll see you over there. If you're not a paid member and you'd like to become one, you can sign up on unknowncountry.com. So another thing, you have so many great resources on your website. And another thing I was really impressed with was you sort of have this roadmap for what's going on with disclosure, kind of like legislatively in Congress, that sort of thing. Can you talk a little bit about that, first of all, about kind of your approach to creating that? And then, you know, I'd love to kind of, then we can maybe dive a little bit more into what you see coming up, because 2024, we've been told it's the year. So far, it's been a little bit of a tough year for us, but I think there's a lot of reason to be hopeful, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on that as well.
No, definitely. And, you know, again, coming back to, you know, you're a product of your environment. Again, coming from the software technology space, a lot of times we're using Kanban boards every day. And so the original idea behind the roadmap was, again, kind of like I talked about at the beginning of this sort of discussion, there's been so much that's happened in Congress around this subject in a 4 to 5 year period. If you look at any other topic that had no political capital at all, and then after 4 or 5 years, how much progress has been made, the only other subject you can probably point to in the modern era during this time period that has had more progress starting from effectively zero in terms of congressional legislative engagement is AI. That's the only other thing. And there's obvious reasons why on the AI side that's true. But the roadmap was really meant to be a helpful reminder for new people to show that, like, this is, you might have come in on one article or one headline, but there's like a whole backlog of stuff that's been happening and like what it actually means, distilling down these 30-page, you know, dense political jargon documents into like, what does this actually mean? Like, what's the practical reality? So for new people is kind of that context. And then for folks who are in the community, it's the constant reminder of how far we've come. There's a lot of poo-pooing that happens because it's like, it's not moving fast enough. I totally get it. I understand that energy. I get it. We're also operating on the government bureaucracy timescale, sort of like the cosmological timescale. We're operating on the government bureaucracy timescale. So if you do a comparative to other subject matters in terms of how quickly, again, they're able to get legislation done, we are above average. And we've been running above average for the last 4 years in terms of not looking at the subject in isolation and thinking about it as this 80-year history, which, yes, it has this 80-plus-year-long sort of truth embargo component to it. But in the modern era in Congress, not a single member in Congress would mention the word UFO or UAP until just after 2017. So the timescale we're talking about for the current cohort in Congress is not 80 years. It is that shorter time period. The folks that are in the executive branch, again, we like to talk about government like a monolith. It's not a monolith. The executive branch is where some of these folks who have been involved with the issue for that longer period of time do exist. And then they try to use what they can to pull the strings for the members that come into Congress. But ultimately, I think we in the U.S., we have a general apathy for political engagement in the modern time. And so finding ways to get people to feel excited, to understand what happens and why it's happening and who's involved was really the entry point behind trying to build out that roadmap. And then it evolved into now one of our boards at the beginning of the year, right? This was after the UAP Disclosure Act failed at the end of 2023. You know, we put together basically one of the other aspects of the space is there's a lot of predictions that happen. A lot of 2 weeks, ooh, rumble, you know, the Jurassic Park, you know, shaky water meme. Like, oh.
Yeah.
But where's, like, you know, having sort of some track record accountability system, right? So we've put at the beginning of the year a bunch of like the main, like the big popular predictions for what was going to come out. Oh, we're going to see a new UAPDA, a Lou's book, you know, Souls event. So a variety of these things, again, as a way to both, you know, keep people. So, you know, there was, as an example, there was a claim that from the attorney Daniel Sheehan that at the end of February that there was going to be a week-long hearings with whistleblowers in the Senate. That didn't happen, right? And a lot of times some of that stuff gets lost by the wayside, but I think it is important and valuable as this continues to go further along that, like, who is bringing forth information and things that when they are trying to get ahead of it being a real thing, that then actually become true? And then to what percentage is that conversion rate? Obviously things happen in politics. So, like, you know, I appreciate Danny's work greatly. He's been a legend in just general advocacy for using the legal system to support people. So I'm not trying to call him out. I'm not trying to just individually call him out or anything like that. But I do think it's important when we talk about on-ramps in the public who already have an existing stigma for us to be honest about when things have a negative impact on the ultimate job we're trying to do here of legitimizing the topic and being overzealous about predictions that don't come true is a big reason why people don't take it seriously. So those were the two sort of entry points for why we ultimately built out that roadmap. We are working on a couple of updates to try to drive, because it allows for user-generated content. So users can go in there and they can put their own things in. So we're trying to find a way to make it more of a core part of what we do. For example, we would use that as a reference on like a biweekly show where we go through the roadmap and kind of talk about different updates and use that as a way to anchor people. But it's one of the things I think was, again, bringing that goal-oriented mindset from tech into the work we're doing here.
Absolutely. No, I think that's really cool. And I think it's like what you're saying, it's important too. I mean, obviously there's a lot going on behind the scenes. There's stuff that they probably have every intention of happening, and then something happens and it doesn't happen. But at the same time, I also think, you know, for anybody who's student kind of the history of ufology, we also have to keep in mind that, like, I guess I'll say this. I find it really helpful to look at not just what people say, but what they do. And that, like, in some ways, like, having some of that tracking and some of that accountability is good. Even if it does come from a place of just, like, people trying to do the right thing, we do need to be a little careful about, like, the information we put out there if we're not sure. But something that I know, one of those kinds of predictions that we've been waiting on for a while, and to lose credit, he hasn't been out there telling people when the book would be out. He waited until he knew for sure.
Perfect example of doing it in a way that, yes.
Yes, exactly. But a lot of other people have made predictions about when this book would come out, and I'm sure you've heard as many of them as I have. But it sounds like we're getting it in August. So, you know, Lou Elizondo has really kind of taken a step back over the last few years, at least from kind of the public-facing side of things. And it seems as though he's been spending a lot of time in Washington, D.C. Do you expect that we're going to see kind of other things happening concurrently with the release of that book? Or do you think that people should maybe be a little hesitant with their enthusiasm on that front?
I think it's a fair question. And maybe the way I would couch it is, not necessarily that the things happening are a direct connection to the book itself, but I think just from a timing perspective, it's going to be a time at which the legislative calendar process will enable the outcome of potentially the UAP Disclosure Act version 2, potentially seeing safe airspace for Americans get in there, among other things, and also lining up with the timeline of what we've already heard about when the next hearings in the House around the UAP subject would be, which now seems to be being slated as after the August recess, sometime in September. Those things are happening independent of Lou's book, but the work that Lou is doing is helping to drive those eventualities in their own independent lanes, if that makes sense.
Totally.
So I don't have any proprietary information that's more than what most people are hearing, that, oh, going into the fall, there's some momentum that's building. I don't really quite, from a PR and strategic perspective, again, just because that's kind of the world that I live in, I sometimes struggle with the approach and the messaging in some things. So it's not clear to me, but there definitely is a increased amount of collaborative conversations and multiple people coming, like working towards the short-term outcomes. So I can just speak purely from the legislative side with sort of primary information, because a lot of the work we do is engaging directly with staffers within Congress and the likes. And, you know, we do know that Lou is meeting with staffers and members regularly through being able to know that from the conversations we have with staffers. So he is definitely on the ground. He's definitely has planned next steps, and I, much like everybody else, am keenly interested to see how he approaches this. If you think about Lou Elizondo's trajectory, it's been a learning process for him engaging with the public. I mean, this is a guy that, you know, used to be involved in and around, you know, that big case at Guantanamo, and obviously was doing the ATIP stuff. He's a CI guy, a counterintelligence guy. It's not someone that is used to public relations in this context. And so I think, you know, we saw him do TTSA and I think learned a lot from that experience. And then he went independent and, you know, we had the unidentified show and, you know, was trying to find the way to, like we were talking about in this whole conversation, to reach people. He's now taken a step back from public media presentations and has gone with the book route, which has been under DOPS review for quite some time. I will just note that I do not believe, this is my own conjecture, I do not believe that his lack of public media presence is 100% his own individual choice. There seems to be circumstances that are making it such that it is advantageous for him to not step out at this moment until things work themselves out. So that seems to be my interpretation, which is the only reason why I'm kind of continuing to maybe, let's be cautiously optimistic, but keep it to just the book for now.
I completely agree. That's really interesting. In terms of what you're looking at coming up, like what are the kind of, like what are the potential initiatives coming up that you're excited about? Or like, what do you have your eye on kind of through the end of the year?
So, you know, over the last several months now, you know, a lot of the political advocacy focused folks or quote unquote big D disclosure folks have really been becoming much more collaborative. So there is now ongoing, you know, conversations as we monitor that the big thing right now is the National Defense Authorization Act for fiscal year 2025. If you guys have been following this issue for the last several years, you know, effectively almost every piece of UFO, UAP related legislation we've gotten has been through this process of the National Defense Authorization Act. Currently in the House version did not have any amendments specific to UAP. The Senate Intelligence Authorization Act, which usually gets brought in and then just added into the NDAA, did include a few provisions that touch on some more procedural things. They're not necessarily huge. So one of which is the ban on funding for unreported UAP programs. Again, cutting off the money spigot, death by a thousand cuts approach, and then some additional whistleblower protection stuff. The big question is where we are in the Senate processes. They're about to go to the floor consideration to finalize their version of the NDAA. Again, for context, the House creates a version of the bill, the Senate creates a version of the bill, then they go into a conference committee and then try to mash it together to get to some agreement. So the House version doesn't really have UAP stuff. The Senate version, some of those procedural things, they're at the place now where members can bring forth amendments to the core NDAA that came out of the Senate Armed Services Committee. And what was interesting there is that they did not include the UAPDA as a part of the original draft coming out of the Armed Services Committee. Some of the arguments are that's because it crosses the jurisdiction of multiple committees, so the place to do so would be on floor consideration. Last year's version of the UAPDA did come out at the same stage too. It's clear that it's going to be brought for consideration. Whether it will make it through or not, I don't think is as obvious. And if it doesn't make it through in the Senate version, that means it's going to be out of play when it goes into conference committee. And there are two reasons. One reason is people always say the gatekeepers are going to get to the people they need to know that they need to in order to make it go away. And now that they already know what's coming, because last year was the element of surprise, they already know it now. The idea is they killed it in the crib this time. I think there's also a less, adversarial view, which is that because of the election context, particularly with Democrats and the Schumer Gillibrand as sort of leading it on the Democratic side in the Senate, there's potentially a perspective because we sort of already know it's come down from the top that Biden and Kirby is NSA person, they don't want to deal with the disclosure issue at all. I think Tim Gallaudet has sort of alluded to this multiple times. And as such, the top-down message, because the whole thing is protect Biden at all costs right now, is going to be don't bring up anything at all that's going to cause me problems. So there could be some tension where it might have been easier last year when the stakes weren't as high, where it's less easy now because there are other political incentives and things to worry about. I do think it's going to be brought forth to the floor. If it makes it to conference, there's already basically everyone is planning huge campaigns in a variety of mediums to make sure that the current issue that happened last year, which was Representative Mike Turner from the Intel Committee and Representative Mike Rogers from the House Armed Services Committee, blocked it because of, you know, alleged connections to the industry. So that's short-term stuff. That's kind of table stakes. It would be great to also see Safe Airspace for Americans pass, which is much less controversial, but really important for being able to support civilian pilot reporting of this issue. One thing we've seen in the last year is that there's a ton of civilian pilot reports that are now making into these news stories. We're getting the ATC recordings, and you're hearing directly from these pilots really compelling testimony from people who've been flying 10, 20, 30 years and are now having experiences that are almost identical and mirror the experience that I had that I talked about in 2012. As we look beyond the end of the year into 2025, here's the most important thing that's going to happen. The 119th Congress is going to start. We're currently in the 118th Congress. The 119th Congress is going to start. And it is not clear if the Democrats will retain control in the Senate or if the Republicans will retain control in the House. The perspective currently is that Republican leadership in the House is not going to move on this issue. I think they're bad at governing generally. So a lot of the problem is that they can't just deal with other stuff because they can't get the basics done. So I think that's an element too, but there's clearly pushback from Republican leadership in dealing with this issue at all. If that were to change to Democratic leadership in the House, where the leadership of the Oversight Committee, the Intel Committee, and the Armed Services Committee can be any number of folks like a Robert Garcia, Representative Garcia, like a Representative Andre Carson, who have all publicly, you know, come out in favor for this and are not afraid to stick their neck out, that could be interesting. The other thing too is the freshman Republicans that are part of the Congressional UAP Caucus could potentially also grow in their power within the party. But the point is, the power of the people that decide what gets through is going to change. The incentives are going to change. And what we're doing now is we're building the political capital to make sure that UAP going into the next Congress is an issue that is in the list alongside AI, alongside anomalous health incidents, alongside, you know, ballistic missile defense as the frontier technology and national security problem that needs to be a consistent part of the conversation that will then subsequently lead to these other things. I will also mention there is already draft legislation for next year being written right now as alternative approaches to the UAPDA approach. So there's a lot of pushback for the UAPDA from a variety of parties around the eminent domain clause and the government having that control. Look, in my view, Republicans are not going to pass a bill that has explicit eminent domain defined in it because it's antithetical to their entire political view. So it's, you know, you could argue that even just from a pure politics perspective, political ideology perspective, there's challenges with getting passed in either party. There's a regulatory approach that's being explored that's really interesting. So I think what we're seeing is all of the entities that are at the bleeding edge now are now coalescing, and we're now beginning to lead instead of follow. So a lot of times historically it'd be like, what's Congress doing? What's Congress doing? And then the insiders would be having their conversations and that's about it. Now there's a larger group of subject matter experts, both from a political context and a technical context, that are saying this is what needs to happen. And providing the guidance to staffers to understand the scope of the problem, and then working again, not only on the sort of the big piece of legislation we need to get passed is some format like the Civilian Review Board to wrangle control out of the current classification and executive branch process. That will enable, and then also whistleblower to protections, that will enable this more crash retrieval program whistleblowers coming forward, being fully protected, And then that will drive week-long hearings like the church committee, et cetera. So it's like a legislation of this variety is a prerequisite to more substantive hearings, more substantive litigation being brought forth around this issue. I don't expect the hearings we see this year to be particularly explosive at this point in time, based on what is publicly known, because it seems to be the case that there is a belief that based on the response to David Grush and the still ambiguity around what the whistleblower protections are, most of the first handers are staying on the sidelines, which may change if Lou's book comes out and is explosive, which may change if we see the House hold a hearing in September after the August recess, where they do bring in the hostile and cooperative witness list from David Grush, as has been suggested by Representative Burchett. I would be extremely shocked and I would welcome this if Chairman Comer would allow a hearing in the Oversight Committee 2 months before the election that have nothing to do with helping Donald Trump win the election. I would be very surprised. But he did, Trump, former President Trump did just have that interview with Logan Paul the other day, where he did talk about being briefed and, you know, that, look, these are serious people. The same thing Rubio said, the same thing Schumer said, the same thing all these people, Obama. So in any event, I think it's people need to recognize that the bureaucratic timescale is long and there haven't really been that many people who have been doing the work to make sure this stuff is happening. And it's already been happening. So a lot of the next 12 to 18 months is going to be the organizational process across entities beginning to actually have exponential impact because we're sort of reinforcing each other through whatever happens with the NDAA and legislation for next cycle.
That's so awesome. And I really appreciate you bringing that level of nuance to it. I think that we lack that, unfortunately, a lot of times when we talk about what's going on in Washington. So I really do appreciate that and the work that you're doing. So what can we expect coming up from the UAP caucus? What are you guys working on and what are you hoping to do in the coming months?
So one of the things we're really trying to get into now is we focused a lot in the first, you know, we've now been 11 months in an official capacity. And a lot of that work has been on white paper, like the core website, and then the white papers for staffers specifically, and really establishing a network of a congressional network of our own direct access. And I think now with where we are, we have our infrastructure in place, and we now have a great network of both us SMEs in the aerospace space and the congressional side. We're looking to start having, what's the way I want to frame this? We're basically just going to starting an interview series that's going to be focused on both members in Congress as well as technical SMEs for this subject matter, particularly not around what has happened, but where do we go? And we think that that's going to be a key way to, again, help people understand. There's so much to talk about what do we do now that is not being talked about. So this explorative series, I think, is going to be really important to also help inspire folks to then now, because one of the things we've seen is as we've brought up ideas and people pick it up, and it's like, oh yeah, I'm going to go be a FOIA warrior on this piece. And that's the kind of work that we need to be doing. So I think that video series is going to be huge. We're going to have a variety of collaborative call campaigns coming out for this legislative cycle in particular. And we do have a couple of platform updates that I'll leave open-ended for now, but we are looking at a couple of different areas to expand our ability to allow people to engage in the subject. So for example, having all of legislation in the system and having our AI chatbot so you can do conversational inquiries into the subject matter. One of the biggest challenges there is figuring out if you include historical data from FOIA requests, you have to weed out things that are emails from people external to government versus things that are interagency communication. So there's some complexity, which is why we're going to start with legislation. But again, we are continuing the Skunk Works approach of trying to build the prototypes for these things that can then scale into other formats. We are also working on some building out two websites for two other important players in the space. We did the new website for AIAAUAP.org, which is the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics UAP Integration and Outreach Committee, which has been huge because they've now seen an increase in recruitment of technical SMEs because of the way the information is presented. So we're going to continue to be doing a lot of that digital building, campaign work, and moving into that video series concept so we can have, I think, conversations that are of a similar tenor to this one, but that are very tactical around, like, you know, talking to a Dr. Gary Nolan. What are the three projects you're working on? Okay, like, so as you look at this aspect of the study, you know, what kind of capital requirements do you have for this and that? How do you see the timeline for reporting? This then is going to, again, attract investors and financing because they can understand there is an industry here that is thinking long term, that is being innovative, and that has a vision for what needs to happen. And again, that's, you know, the rising tide lifts all boats kind of situation. So we're just extremely excited for a variety of again, orthogonal efforts, because we need to be setting up. We have no infrastructure. It's really nascent right now. So that all needs to be created from scratch. And we're just, you know, really grateful that we've been able to have the opportunity to participate in that with many folks alongside yourself as well, Kelly.
Well, Lester, it's been so great to get to know you a little bit. I'm so excited about what you guys are working on. And, you know, I hope that we can find ways to collaborate in the future. I think you guys are doing really, really great work. Where can people find you?
So on every social, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, it's at Lester Nare, L-E-S-T-E-R-N-A-R-E. And then UAPcaucus.com for the main platform. If you have ideas, anything, always feel free to reach out, DM, shoot an email over our contacts on the website. Always looking to find ways to connect folks if we can't be helpful. But let's be inclusive. Let's stop being exclusive. Let's work together. Let's find ways to connect the dots here. I'm open to any and all that want to reach out. Twitter is probably the place that I'm most active on. So a lot of the real-time analysis, if you're interested in the government stuff and like the minute updates, that's a great place for you to go. But otherwise, those are the big things. And again, Kelly, I really appreciate the work that you're doing. And I can't wait to see. I know you have a lot of irons in the fire. So I'm really excited to see those begin to sort of make the light of day and then continue to elevate the conversation you've already been having.
Oh, well, thank you so much. It's been great having you. Thanks again, Lester.
Likewise.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.